previously with the Liberators.
I think more importantly, I've discovered gratitude in my heart, guys. This has been the best adventure ever.
Now, what are we gonna do?
Okay, we found compassion under the ice. So, as far as I'm aware, this is a part of Mylar, and there's still two more parts to find. As far as I can interpret the riddles, which I'm not good at, somehow I like hold another shard, or we have a shard amongst us, and it's not this one that Korik has, but the three still need to be united. But until we can puzzle this out, I don't know if we should just follow Landis for the time being and go back. I don't know if we stay on this continent and piece together more clues.
We sent away, or, you know, Demu and the Warforge Reap, and just asked us, if of any of these Durais or Frenchal Capitalists, let us know. Do you have any information? And no, we did not give them information. And then they left. And now these wizardy dudes just mysteriously showed up all of a sudden. And they said they need to take Landis to the Primarch, and I don't trust them. Everybody else trusts them, I don't.
So Rorin said this all out loud at the bar, right? He's like recapping because he's so drunk.
Rorin's still a little drunk.
Spit water on my microphone.
Rorin, you see symbols of the Shrike Temple on these.
Oh, guys. Okay. This just got easy. All right.
Then he's going to throw his axe down, and then he's going to pull his gauntlets off, and he's going to grab you. Please make a athletics check.
Wait, athletics?
Yeah, do you owe this dude money or
I
something?
I stood in the middle of this field. That was my first mistake.
He grabs you, and instead of moving out of his spot, he's actually pulling you into his spot.
Ooh.
And he rips his helmet off. You're looking into the face of Arden. He smiles at you, and then he laughs, and he's like, "You can't stop the conflict, Rorin. And I want you to make a dexterity saving throw."
There we go.
You lean back as he goes in for a head bash, and then out of nowhere he releases your grip and you hear a very loud crunching sound. And when you recover yourself, you look, and his head is totally smashed in and his armor is caved in.
Arden is dead. Thanks to, Korak here, honestly.
What?
Arden is dead? Okay, well, I guess we'll start with the group. Carised is leading you guys back into the underground tunnels. And he, because I think it's like evening, it's late, right? Like it's dark out, it's nighttime, and you guys were ready to kind of settle in for the night. He's leading you down this really long tunnel. You're heading like north. You walk for quite a while, and then you get to you start hearing more sounds from the outside, and you come up into a wine cellar of sorts that looks really overgrown with moss and grass. It's really dark in here. Carised goes in and lights a little lantern, but he dims it. He keeps it really dim, and you guys walk upstairs, and you see that this is a pretty broken down house, and he kind of shrugs when you guys are looking around, and he's just like, "Well, sorry, this is the best we've got. It's safe, though, I promise, and the sleeping quarters are pretty nice, so..."
So, what's the plan? We're just gonna wait for Rorin to regroup with us, or...?
Yeah, my plan was to go back and get him. He knows these tunnels pretty well. I'm not concerned about him finding his way. I've added some new tunnels, but he'll know all the old ones. This is one of our older stomping grounds, if you will. Something that... It's a place that Rinian never knew about, even though he found the tunnels. He just filled a couple of them in, I think. And so it's helped out a lot.
Well, thank you for the place to stay. Is this wine up for grabs, or is this personal property of someone else?
Yeah, sure. Take it.
Medusa grabs a handful.
Gob would look for the right vintage from Tuxankar.
We'll call it there's an Amarantine Red.
Okay.
Pinot.
Perfect. This is what I'll be drinking tonight. If there's any more, I'll pocket them too, or put them in my bag. But
wait, you guys, do you think Rorin hasn't been drinking water this whole time?
This whole journey is just leading for me to have this giant level of respect for Rorin I didn't have already. No wonder he drinks so much.
What saving throw do we need to perform now?
You're surprised in that way that when you think about it, you're like, how did I not know? This is one of those things that's going to keep Korak awake at night.
Korak will remember this.
It was never water. So Kara said... Sorry, I'm just thinking about this picture. Kerstedt's like, all right, here's the safe house to sleep. The bed's right. He turns around and you guys are just like scavenging the wine cellar. Oh, okay, take your time. But once you guys are all done, he leads you up to a hallway in like the second floor. And you can tell that immediately that this has been taken care of a lot better on the second floor. And there is a set of rooms down this long hallway. And as you look in, there's beds in all the different rooms. And some of them are in different states of disrepair or cleanliness, I should say. What are you looking for, Medusa?
The best room and bed, obviously.
Oh, yeah. There's one that's like at the very end of the hallway to the left is a big like master bedroom. And it's
this
got,
is mine.
It's got a big...
I'm having Frumpkin just like nuzzling the sheets, just like we're marking this area. This is ours now.
Kara said, just he nods his head. He's like, oh, all right, yep, okay. And then he shows the rest of you to like. Unfortunately, there a lot of them are shared rooms. So he's like, you'll have to bunk up. I hope that's not weird, but that's all we've got. I have other people on watches who are going to be coming back here at some point. They need to make sure that they have their beds available to them. But here's a room here. Let's see. Medusa got a room to herself, and then there'll be two sets of you who'll need to bunk up, two to a room, and then one other person who'll get a room to themselves. Not to themselves, but you'll share another bed, but it'll be have someone else in there. And with that arcana check...
What are you doing?
I'm investigating, obviously.
Is there something magical about the room?
Very interesting. You get really paranoid because you start feeling a presence in the house that feels a little bit like how do I say, jet wash off of the shards that you guys have pulled out of the Black Lake and like Webby's pockets and stuff.
Kandaros, this room's haunted. Trade me.
Haunted, you say?
Did you see a ghost in there?
Jesus Christ.
I felt one.
Yeah, Korak, you're in the same boat as Medusa. You get really paranoid.
See, start, it's haunted. Kandaros
believes
me.
Start feeling this weird, like... reverberation.
The Liberators
of magic.
Need to be a little more trusting and supportive.
Let me take a look. Me and Jeffrey will look.
Yeah, get in on this.
There's fucking ghosts in here.
I love Ignis. Ignis is like, yes, ghosts.
Why is your hideout haunted? Is it previous members? Is this the cult responsible?
JF, you... see a bed that looks like someone has been in it.
Do I see it or do I perceive it?
You perceive in all spectrums. I guess that's really all I have to say about that. Gob, with your 19 arcana, you definitely feel what you could consider to be ripples of magic that feel very similar to the shards.
Like a shard is close, or like the shards we're carrying is kind of producing it.
If everything around you in the magic spectrum is like liquid and something sends ripples through it, and you are holding what if like... Let me know if this analogy doesn't make any sense to you when I'm done explaining it, but... you are standing in a pool... holding the shard that you have, right? And you drop it into the pool, and you watch the ripples that it makes, and you watch how those ripples go out everywhere, and you could recognize those ripples. Well, it's not the act of something dropping in that you're thinking, oh, there's a shard here, but you're looking at these ripples of magic, so to speak, and you can't help but think, that looks really familiar to me. Like, maybe something or someone was around here that has that magic on them, and it's sort of dragging those ripples around.
Did you find the ghost?
Place is haunted.
I knew it. We are out of here. I am not dealing with ghosts.
But there's a sense of the shards here too. So maybe it's not something we should leave. It almost feels like a shard has been here before. Everyone look around. Look under your bed. Maybe it's still around here somewhere.
Look under your bed!
I'm gonna investigate that bed.
I found it in the tank of the toilet.
What do I find? What do I find?
We are not going to sleep until we know it's safe.
See, Mr. Webby had the idea, stab every bed. But no.
Mr. Webby is right. Medusa, you start looking for magical things. Or things... ghost things.
Under the bed.
You go into the same room that Jeff was in. You see there's like one bed that's all made up and ready for someone to sleep in it. There's another bed there that looks like it's been slept in already, or that someone was in it recently in some form. And there's like a small chest of items nearby. Do you call attention to that at all?
Oh, yeah. Kandaros, look, chest. And I'm going to arcana check and see if it's... Ah.
So there's no... In the same way that, like, now that Gob has kind of suggested that there's shard, you know, god shards about, and you know how, like, what to look for, you start to understand that, yeah, whoever's in this bed has something to do with these shards, right? Yeah, Korak, there's something about these possessions that looks really familiar to you, that feels really familiar to you. And the best way I can put it is that you do a little bit closer of an inspection with that 21 investigation, and you see what appears to be maybe some kind of snake scales.
Oh, okay. And in my current life, I think the only one I've met is Sanigar.
That is correct.
Do you want me to roll anything to confirm that, or...?
You could make a history check, but make it with advantage. Yeah, looking at these possessions and kind of racking your brain about, you know, what you can tell about these scales and what that might mean. Yeah, you're 100% sure that these are scales from a Corianid person. And the only living Corianid that you're aware of is Sanigar. And all these possessions totally match that. The last time you saw him was standing with Raylene Kawahara in Master's Point before you left on your great 2-year-long journey.
Okay. In that case, I would probably pick up one of the scales and hold it up to Gob. I can only think of one coronet we've met who would drop these off.
You thinking Sanigar?
How sexy does the scale look to you?
Yeah, it looks like the sexiest scale I've ever seen. Think he's helping out here in Rivershroud, then? It'd be great to see him.
So I would assume if Sanigar was here, he was allied or helping with interests much like ours, but...
I know he was an ally back then. I don't know if you've heard anything, but I haven't heard anything from Raylene basically since we left, the two of them too. Maybe we should find him, talk to him, see what he knows.
Okay, so Medusa, your history check, I think they're talking about Corianid, Sanigar, etc., etc. Medusa's old enough to have known the Corianid in their prime. And so looking at the things that Sanigar has in his, like, possession, that in this box, right, of this person that everyone's calling Sanigar, it tracks, because the Corianid were known for being creative back in the day before the war. And so a lot of the things that he, you know, he's got like a journal, he's got some like some color pencils and things like that, and you know, thick parchments and things to draw on, and basically he's a creative. And your insight check, I'm unsure of where that was supposed to be. I think I might have missed the context.
I'm trying to find out how sexy those scales are. You gotta tell me now, DM. You gotta tell me.
Sploosh. Okay, so you guys are you settling in for the night?
Yeah.
Not me.
Yep.
It's a stakeout.
I'd be interested in settling in the room that we may assume that Sanigar will return to.
Okay, we go over to Rorin.
Rorin's chilling invisible in his own house, worried for his sister and father.
Okay, are you talking to them just like invisible?
Well, I believe we left them. They were, the Shrike cultists were coming upon the house, and there was yelling, or not yelling, but there was a disturbance that was, looked like it was a tense moment for my sister.
Did she go out to see what was the commotion?
I thought we left it where she did open the door.
Okay, yeah, there's like a mob of, from where you can see, like you're invisible, Gob cast invisibility on you. There's a mob of Shrike priests and acolytes and things like that. They're all holding torches and pitchforks because that's what you do. There's one guy who's in the lead. He's got a big eye patch over his left eye. And he's looking at your sister and he's like, Talara, we need to see Reardon. In fact, we need to search the house. And Talara's arguing with him. Obviously, like, that can't happen. What are you doing at this time?
Rorin is in the main part of the house. He's close to Talara. He wants to overhear this, but unless she knew Gob cast invisibility, I think he's not going to let anyone know he's still there.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone actually saw that happen.
Okay. Then, just knowing I'm invisible, I am just eavesdropping at the door there where she is.
Okay, so yeah, Talara's like, you've got to be crazy to think that you're coming in here. And the guy's like, Talara, I'm not kidding. All right, it's time to move. You've had your stand. It's all well and good. You've done your duty. Now let us in. We're going to talk to Reardon. And you see your father, Reardon, sort of, if I remember correctly, he was in a chair last, right? Was it like a wheelchair type thing?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah, so he's like slowly rolling himself into the room, and he's like, it's all right, Talara, let them in. And she steps aside. And these guys immediately set to work. They go everywhere, searching the whole house. Please make a stealth check. Let's see, I'm going to say there's probably like 7 or 8 of these guys who have all just moved into the house and are searching it with an efficiency that only speaks to the fact that this is a regular procedure for them. This is a search team. They're used to doing this. They're professionals. However, you're able to sidestep around them. You don't bump into anything. You don't squeak any boards. All your memories of this house come back, so you're able to, like, oh, that's a squeaky board, or, oh, you know, that's a door jam that'll, you know, make a sound if I get too close to it. And there's, at one point, you're sort of moving in through the kitchen as someone's kind of walking in. You're walking backwards as this guy's kind of coming towards you at not a hurried pace, so you're able to step carefully backwards. And then at the last second, you remember that there's a you know, some pots and pans that are hanging from a little rack, and you're able to duck your head, and you don't hit them and make any noise. But then the temple priest, he, you know, he's looking at something else as he walks in, and he runs right into the pots and pans and makes a, you know, huge crash. And everyone's like, what was that? And he's like, ah, nothing.
Is Talara near me?
You make your way back around to, she went in and grabbed your father and rolled him back into the study where he was when you originally talked to him. And she's just sort of sitting in there as these people run around the house. There's, you know, all these crashing noises and things. And there's one person in the room with you, and he's looking through a bookcase. Just kind of throwing books off of the shelf and like moving it around and looking for stuff. But he's kind of off in the corner and he looks pretty distracted.
So after being disturbed by the ransacking of books,
yeah, Rorin's never done that before.
Nope. How dare he? I'm gonna walk up to Talara and cast this. Just enough where she can see me and whatever.
I want you to make a sleight of hand check. Talara stiffens up when you hit her with that spell. You were trying to... So here's the funny thing. You're invisible. But because you didn't cast the invisibility spell, you're... to use a big word, your proprioception is a little bit off. You can't see your hands like you would normally be able to if you had cast the spell on yourself. You still have like awareness of your limbs, right? But there's a little bit of a disconnect as you go to like try to gently like grab her hand to like let her know like this is you and help calm her before casting this spell. Unfortunately, you kind of bump the chair for a second before you actually get her hand, and it causes her to freeze up for a second, and the acolyte in the room stops ransacking this bookshelf and like this desk and things as he sees her flinch, and he's like, "What? Am I scaring you, Talara? This isn't the first time we've been here, dear." And she's like having trouble not making eye contact with you because she can see you now, and she kind of stammers, "And what are you going to try to do to help her out with this?"
First, I think I will put my finger to my lips and just...
She blinks to let you know that she acknowledges that.
Oh, good.
And just kind of stops stammering and then glares daggers at this guy. And he stops for a second and he's looking at her kind of intently. And then he shrugs and he goes back to searching the desk. So she looks at you. What are you doing?
I'm just going to give her right now a look of like, "Look, I'm here. Everyone is okay right now." Somehow I have to silently communicate to her. All right, I'll do a message on her. I mean, I'm next to her, so do I just touch her or something?
No, I think you just have to be able to see her.
Yeah. So I just want to communicate short message. Everything's okay. I'm here. Just first off, pretend I'm not. Secondly, keep me posted in case things go down. I have to start throwing fireworks at these guys.
She's able to whisper back to you. And after you tell her everything's fine, let me know if I need to jump in. She's like... she looks at you and she says, "There's a box in Father's room that has a seal on it. You need to get that and hide it or destroy it. It has information of the underground."
Oh, I'm going to go get it.
Okay, make a stealth check, please.
Ooh.
You start walking up the stairs and there's a man coming down the stairs. And these are really... This is a really narrow passageway. You see that he's holding a box that has a seal on it. And before I tell you the rest of what happens, are you going to try to grab it?
Yep, I'm going to try.
Okay, I want you to make a sleight of hand check. You smack this box out of his hand, but you do it in a way that... makes him feel like maybe he lost his footing. But the problem is that you do this at the time that he was already about to run into you. So he basically gets like side clotheslined by an invisible barrier. And then this box goes slamming out of his hands. He starts to like fall down the stairs. And obviously there's a huge commotion. So there's like four more cultists who are running in from other rooms. And they're like, "What happened? What happened?" And he looks up the stairs and he's like searching and he can't see anything. And he's like, there's someone else here. What are you going to do?
Okay, did I grab the box or is the box on the ground?
You were able to stop it from falling down the stairs. The priest is, or the acolyte who is carrying it is at the bottom of the stairs. You are about one third of the way up and the box is at your feet. And they are all staring up the stairs about to do something.
I am probably going to do a stealth to silently head up the stairs. I will probably try to find a way of escape through a window.
Okay. Are you leaving the box?
Oh, I thought you said I had it.
It's at your feet.
Oh, it's at my feet. Damn it.
Make an arcana check as you feel a tingle on the back of your neck. That sword you picked up is calling to you. You can feel it like static electricity on the back of your neck.
I guess I'm gonna pull out the sword.
One guy, one of the five people that's standing at the base of the stairs, moves his hands and speaks an incantation, and then all five of them, their eyes glow for a second, and then they all make eye contact with you. I want you, are you going to attack, or are you going to run, or are you going to, what are you doing?
Whatever the first guy in front of me is.
Okay, you draw the sword, and you lunge. And you plant that sword right into his heart. And there is a blast of divine light that comes out of the sword. And it throws all five of them, or all the other four at least, up against the wall behind you. And the one man is dead on the end of your sword. And the others are basically knocked out. But the problem is the other three acolytes slash priests in this house are now running towards your position. What are you going to do? And you hear Talara scream from the other room as this blast goes out.
I need to find Talara or Rinian. I need to protect them.
Did you mean Riordan?
Riordan, sorry. Yeah.
I was like, Rinian's not here, but that's an interesting... That's an interesting goal.
I'm just gonna call these guys out to give me a little protection at the time.
Awesome. Do they stay with you?
Yes.
Excellent. Tiny little Christopher Lees are...
Yes, the little
here.
Christopher Lees are helping me now.
Drawing tiny little curved lightsabers.
So I'm following Talara's scream.
Okay, so you pick up that box and you go sprinting into the other room where Talara is, like, she's grabbed Riordan, the little wheelchair, and she's, like, starting to try to move for the door to go outside. And there is one priest who's starting to enter from the door, not the door that you came in from, but the one that's, like, there's another one in this room to another... like another parlor kind of room. And he's like sprinting in and you hear the other two footsteps from the other two people in this house are somewhere further down. One of them's upstairs where you were about to head and there's another one further down in the house. Maybe they were down in the cellar.
That's a lot.
And in order to get out of the house, you're going to have to travel over these five bodies in this hallway.
Okay, so give me a description. Which one's the like closest to me, which ones are closest to Talara and Riordan?
The closest person to all of you is the guy who's running in from another parlor, and the other two are still, as of yet, out of sight.
Okay. But we see the guy coming out from the parlor?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to cast Flame Strike on that guy.
Are you still holding the sword when you cast this?
Yes, I have a one-handed sword and one-handed the box. Oh, shit, I see what you're saying. Because the sword isn't really my holy symbol.
Well, you cast the spell without really thinking. You're just you're in the zone, right? And you don't even think about it. It feels so natural holding the sword. As you cast this and you're holding the sword, you look at the hilt and at the base of the blade going into the hilt. And there is a holy symbol on it.
Yes.
And There is a huge burst of light and heat, and that man is gone.
Oh, because that was the sword he found after the battle? Okay, gotcha.
Yes, yes, yes.
Why didn't I pick up the sword?
It's mine.
Yeah, there's a scorch mark in that parlor where he once was.
Not the parlor.
Rorin in the parlor with the magic sword.
So I'm assuming my family is making for the front door.
Yes, Talara has Riordan over the bodies. You hear someone shout, "Hurry!" And then you hear Talara scream, and a man launches himself down the stairs and tackles Talara and topples over your father.
He's going to blade barrier him.
Oh, man. Okay. Wow.
Can't mess with Rorin. He's on his home turf.
No. That's an 8 and a 9. Because he's rolling with disadvantage because he is airborne at the time that you cast this. So you hear him go, "Hey!" And then your sister screams, and then he turns into bloody ribbons as he passes through these floating blades. Just dousing the... Wow, Rorin, you're like scary right now. Just absolutely dousing the hallway here in deep crimson blood. Splattering over the unconscious bodies, the body of the man that you stabbed through the heart, and onto your father and your sister.
Sorry.
Talara doesn't even say anything. She just picks Riordan back up and pushes for the door.
I'm going to follow them, try to protect them. Are the other guys still coming after us?
There's someone else that you can hear, but they're still too far away. You can get out the door without even seeing them, I would bet.
We're gonna escape.
Okay. Alright, you guys get out of the house.
I'll probably make
and you
whatever is the next closest entrance to the tunnels.
Okay, you take the lead, and you lead Talara through into the woods nearby the house. You see more torchlight, what you assume is more priests or even maybe the Rivershroud, like lawmen, are approaching the house. You lead Talara and your father through the forest to a little area where you had there was a big, gigantic, like sequoia tree stump, something that was cut down even before you were born, and you push on a little notch on the trunk, and it opens up into the tunnels. And it's funny because you see Carised standing there, and he's like, "Bloody hell, Rorin, what did you do?"
No time for questions.
Literally bloody hell.
They were gonna attack me, and they almost got our secret of the underground. We need to hide.
Yep, I think you're right. I'm going to guess that the house that's a burnt asset. I'm going to go collapse the tunnel. You get them to the safe house. And then he describes the house that you know very well, so you know how to get there. And he runs off to go collapse the tunnel.
Goodbye, house.
You get back to the safe house with Riordan and Talara to see... everybody crowded into one tiny room with two beds in it. And Medusa is rubbing some scales on her. And Gob is going through a trunk.
Rorin, you gotta try this wine. Here, let me get you a glass.
Something smells like burnt people.
It's just this vintage.
Don't mind that. Why are you pilfering through our wine?
But we're guests.
Yeah. your cousin said it was cool. So
I'm the one who failed my hospitality check.
Why wouldn't we be?
Well, thankfully we saved my family and the secret of these tunnels from that Shrike mob. So for the temporary time being, we are safe.
Cool. So everything went smooth up top.
Very smoothly. A little traumatic on my end, but. I'm good.
Yeah, Talara's got like a 1,000-yard stare.
I check on them. Are you guys okay?
She looks at you and she's like, When the hell did you learn how to do all that? That's... I never in a thousand years would have thought that you could have done something like that. What happened?
Look, sometimes you gotta learn that, yes, all of life is precious, but when there is evil out there, and especially when it's attacking the ones you love, you gotta just do something about it. I had to learn ways of defense and killing that I am not proud of.
Her eyes well up with tears, and she grabs you and hugs you, and she's just like, oh, Rorin. And then she says, thank you. Thank you for saving us. And then Reardon goes, even if it was kind of your fault.
Shut up, Dad.
He's just giggling. Maybe surprisingly to you, he's not super phased. He seems pretty all there other than being tired and sick.
You're going to have to remind me before I say anything else. Did I already talk with them about, well, shoot, I'm hoping we can all rest up with more than just two beds.
Oh, there's plenty of beds.
Oh, okay.
Kara said, when he eventually comes back, he's like, I'll just have to, I'll go get some cots or something, and he heads out and grabs some other like supplies to set up sleeping areas, so that when his people come back, he wants to make sure Reardon has a bed.
You should all join us in hiding this room. Put the jump on the snake man.
Snake man.
Sanigar's got some other interest here. Has something to do with the bearkin. I'm really not sure, but I know he spends a lot of time out there with them near the river.
I heard you mention these bearkin last time, too. Are they what they sound like? Bear people? That, are they helpful? Are they enemies? Or?
It's very meta. Very meta, Gob. I'm glad you asked.
I just have to know.
Yes, the bearkin, there's seven different tribes of bearkin, located all around the world. You know, we just happen to be closest to the tribe of the river bearkin. There's a mountain bearkin over on Iadenton. The forest bearkin are down in Elsira. Well, the Arctic bearkin, they're also on Iadenton, but they stick close to the Chigota Sea. Desert bearkin are over on Dilge. They have some kind of a temple out there.
Do you know what dealings he has with them?
I don't know the specifics of his operation. I just know that he has some working relationship with them. They're not, I mean, Rorin, you know the bearkin. They're not like unhospitable, but they certainly like to keep to themselves.
They're not the friendliest of neighbors.
Yeah, I've never seen anyone as accepted by them as he is. It always struck me as odd, but you know, he's giving me a hand finding supplies and getting supplies from the bearkin to bring back here, and he's able to move it quite stealthily. They have their own routes through the forest that evade the Shrike Temple patrols. So I am trying not to look a gift horse in the mouth. If he has something going on with them, I'm happy to let him have that.
Do you think they would be good allies against the Shrike cultists?
I think they would be good allies. I don't know how easy it's going to be to convince them to help us fight the Shrike Temple. The Shrike Temple mostly leaves them alone. They don't really have a reason to be angered by him, as far as I know.
And out of character, does Sanigar have anything against the Shrike Temple?
Oh, yeah. What's that history check for there, Korak?
We'll just say Korak was thinking about something, and he'll just ask it. Do we know how old the bearkin is out here? How long have they lived here? How old are the people?
You know, I think mechanically, Korak, or rather Aaron, let me start referring to all of you by your character names forever. Aaron, from now on, when you make a history check, I want you to make it with advantage. Just because you have this ability to recall Lots of memory. You know that Bear can exist. You also know that there was a time when they did not exist. Much like the Etter Cap. That did not exist at one point until suddenly they were.
The Bearkin. You haven't met the Bearkin yourself. He's never relayed messages to you from the Bearkin. He's just, he has an interest in
them. Oh, I've met the Bearkin. And he gives a knowing look to Rorin. He's like, we know the Bearkin. We've had our own run-ins with them. They've been coexisting with Rivershroud for some time. And, you know, Rivershroud, Anarka, Tyakos, Windbluff. Occasionally they do trade. They mostly just keep to themselves, though.
They don't seem to like the Shrike's Temple, do they?
Like I said, they don't really have a flag in this game. They don't have a dog in this fight. They don't have a spoon in this ice cream. They don't have a ship in this sea. They don't have a... Let me see if any other analogies I can come up with.
Other than their own survival, they're not really interested in fighting.
They're a very closed off community. They don't talk about themselves much. They have some purpose that I'm unsure of. And I think Riordan actually like comes rolling into the room at this point, causing the whole house to bow out because of how many people are stuffed into this room. And he's like,
well, first of all, let me say I'm shocked that my son and my nephew would be sneaking out of the house when they were younger and consorting with the bears.
And then he winks. He's like,
yes, you think that you tricked your old man, but you did not.
I stare at him, feigning innocence.
Yes, okay, well, you can keep playing that way, but that's fine. The Bearkin have existed alongside Rivershroud as far as I've ever been alive. And as Kara said, has explained, they are very secretive. Now, I don't really know Sanigar much. I had some relations with him, some professional relations with him some time ago when he was still a diplomat. But I remember even back then he had some mission he was working on, and it seemed to revolve around the Bearkin. They came up in conversation quite a bit. He didn't like talking about what the mission was. I just knew he was doing something. He was always busy, always asking questions.
And then I think Riordan looks at Jeff and he's like,
I don't recognize you. Where are you from?
I can't really remember.
Oh, that's too bad.
Just kind of around.
You an orphan?
Yes.
Well, that's a shame. Maybe,
I don't know. I moved around so much as a, like, young kid, but I don't really remember.
What is that? What is that symbol you've got there on your jacket? Looks like a dragon. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's a dragon.
You study dragons? What's your profession?
I don't really have a profession. I'm just kind of jack of all trades, you know, good at magic, that sort of thing.
I see. Did you spend much time in Dilge? I seem to recall seeing that symbol somewhere in Dilge. It's hard to recall. I could be getting that wrong. Maybe it was closer to Harpcry.
Yeah, probably Harpcry. I've spent most of my time down there in Higher Orwan.
If you ever remember where you're from, I'd love to hear the tale.
Yeah, me too.
Myself am something of a dragon fanatic.
And he kind of casts a sidelong glance at Ignis.
Ship up.
Slowly step away. Man, not Rorin's dad, too.
I hope you'll forgive an old man's curiosity. I
think he's kind of giggling as he's realized like what he said out loud to like a dragonborn in the room.
I've always loved the tale of Indipidus the Blue.
It's quite the tale. Indipidus.
That name sounds kind of familiar. Where have I heard that name before, Indipidus?
Riordan looks really excited. He's like,
ah, yes, the tale of Indipidus. He was the great blue dragon. Should be ancient blue dragon at this point, I think. But dragon of immense power, said to be formed from the dust of gods.
What did you say?
I heard Impetus was actually dead. Exploded in a flash of color when he had to face the great wizard Oral.
Oh yes, most recently Oral. Oral the Excellent and his band of wizards went seeking him and trying to find the armor of... it's probably not important, but... Yes, no,
Makes me feel really sad for some reason to hear that dragon died.
Well, it's unclear whether or not Indipidus actually died. There's many who believe he's still out there traveling across the plains. The legend goes he was made of raw god stuff, so really it, you know, could be anywhere. Could be right here, right now. not just kidding.
Rorin's not laughing, as he has the face of a mathematics woman.
The legend I was told was that armor of Osiris could actually control him.
The armor of Osiris, that's what that is.
And then he looks back at Jeff, and he's like,
that's where I've seen that symbol before.
And Gob, I actually want you to make a history check with advantage. You finally look at this, like, pin that, this buckle that Jeff has on his jacket, and it matches the some of the symbols that you have seen on the armor that you collected from Zenaitha.
I would keep talking to Rorin's dad, though. Not draw attention to it at this moment in time. But yeah, the legend goes, you have all the armor, you can control the dragon.
That's what I've understood about it. What's going on here? I feel like I've said something. You all have experience with this.
And he's actually looking at Gob when he says that. He's like,
something passed across your face. Yeah, you know this dragon or this legend. Well.
These are just old stories my dad used to tell me, bringing back memories of him, that's all.
Well, they are good stories, but it ends a little sadly. In my lifetime anyway, I was able to understand that the story of Oral the Excellent actually came to an end, so that is sad, but at least you have these memories. Good, even if they're a little bit sad, as your father passed, too?
Yes, he passed about the same time as Oral the Excellent.
Why don't you tell me about your snake-headed friend over here? She's a Medusa. What's going on with that, Rorin? How do you all know each other? Where are you from? There, Medusa.
I'm from Elcira, but a very, very long time ago.
Back before they built the fort? Back before Gauntlet started his reign?
Yeah.
Very interesting. There's very few people who can remember far enough back before the War Master took over.
Remember the past?
Remember the past. And then finally his gaze comes to rest on...
And you, my friend. Tell me where you're from.
Depends. How much time do you have?
Didn't tell an old man a story. I have plenty of time.
I just smile at Rorin and then look at his father and just say, do you know Garrisel?
Yes.
Oh, I'm his son.
Well, can't say I was expecting that one, but okay. You're not the first demigod I've met in my time, but you are the first that I've met of Garrisil.
I also asked a bit about Sanigar, because we actually met him in Master's Point some time ago. And if he took interest in Rivershroud, it makes me curious if there's something more going on that we need to know about. Maybe that we can help with.
Yes, Sanigar, yes. I don't know what his business is here, but if he's working with Carised, then I'm sure you'll have an opportunity to meet with him. And if he finds out you're here, then there's a very good chance he'll come and find you. We can wait for that to happen. Talara, would you grab me another blanket, please?
And there's a pause, and he's like,
Talara.
And you guys look around, and Talara is gone. Rorin, you see a note written in Talara's hand. It basically says, gotta go, have to find husband and children.
Oh, shit.
Do you think your sister's in trouble out there? Or in danger, I guess?
I should have thought of this earlier, but those cultists might come after her family.
What time is it?
It's like probably midnight right about now. It's very late. Rorin puts his hand on your arm, Rorin.
Rorin.
Let me repeat Rorin. This whole sentence.
Rorin, son of Rorin, son of Raiden.
Rorin. Rorin reaches out and puts his hand on your arm, and he says,
"I know that she's your younger sister, and you worry after her, but she's quite capable. If she's gone to get Alton, then I'm sure they'll be fine. Alton's a capable wizard."
I need a location spell. I'm scared for her, guys. Kara said, you didn't see her leave?
I was just keeping an eye out on the tunnels, making sure I didn't hear anything. She must have gone out through the forest, which is not great. If she's seen coming from here, this could burn the safe house, but I'm trusting that she took the precautions necessary. Is she acting strange at all? I think she's mentally okay? I don't know what happened.
Other than being traumatized by what I did to those priests, I think she's okay, but those priests are probably looking for her and for her family.
I know it's hard, Rorin, but if we all go, we might actually be putting her in more danger. One person's a lot harder to find than all of us. That being said, if you want to go, I'll go with you.
Thanks, Gob.
Did Korak meet her? I can't remember.
Yeah, she came in with you guys. Or she came in with Rorin and Rorin for very brief.
Rorin, would you want to ask her a question? Would that ease your mind?
Oh, yes. Okay, well, with that, then I like to send a message to freak her out and say, yo, sis, are you okay?
Out there in the world somewhere, Talara hears Korak's voice in her head that says, yo, sis, you doing okay? Is that literally what you're going to say? Is, yo, sis, are you good?
I'll elaborate more if Rorin's cool with that.
Make it clear that it's Korak speaking.
BTW, this is Rorin V and Korak.
I'll leave it at that. Yeah, that. Rorin's basic like, hey, by the way, this is Rorin talking through his attractive friend, and then I'll have his message.
You hear back. Okay, that's weird, but I'm good. We're getting the kids out. Be gone for a while.
Damn, I don't think I learned anything new. I should have thought about that harder. Do we know where the kids are, Rorin?
I guess she could have sent back with Alton now, getting the kids out.
With Alton now?
It doesn't sound like she's not in danger yet. She didn't say, oh my god, this is happening.
There's an urgency to the message, but it's not a panic.
Okay. I'm just going to tell her to please be careful. We'll have Kara said help you.
Alright, I'm not going to burn another spell slot.
Okay,
I love you, bro,
sorry, I didn't.
Yeah, she's not here. She's not here. Not. I love you, but I'm a warlock.
Sorry, warlock. Okay.
I'm just teasing.
Is there anything else you guys want to do for the evening, or are you going to call it a night?
I just want to ask Carised to see if he or anybody he knows can go make sure.
He looks at you and he gives you like a, come on. He's like, I've already sent a message out.
Just making sure. In my ways,
just trying to get people out there to help her. Of course. She's central to the underground. She's going to be taken care of, Rorin. Okay. Don't worry.
Glad you all got this handled. I don't even know what's been going on.
How long have you been out of Rivershroud for?
Years.
30 years? 30, 35 years?
So many years. Decades.
I've been doing this about 30 years.
Okay, I trust you. We might need a rest here.
Yeah, I would suggest that everyone gets some sleep. It's been a long night, and I imagine we're going to have a long time. It's going to be a long few days. And with that, I think as long as nobody has anything they want to do, we could say you guys go to sleep, rest up, wake up the next day. Rorin, when you look at the sword the next morning, the holy symbol that you saw light up on it has changed slightly, and it now looks partially as though the symbol that it had on it before, which you would recognize to be Agrishad, the symbol for Agrishad, it has started to sprout some branches as though the symbol of Pleth is intertwined with it. Yeah, this is not like a regular sword or a regular holy symbol. I think we kind of touched on that. This is the avatar of Agrishad. And because it's not just a regular holy symbol, it is actual, like, divine presence. It is able to interact with other pieces of divinity like that. And so your holy symbol has sort of merged with it. So you can use them interchangeably. You can use your staff or you can use the sword. Okay, you wake up the next day and you wake up. Korak, are you sleeping in that room that Sanigar was supposed to be in?
Yeah, I would do my best to kind of sleep in kind of an alert position, but I would definitely still allow myself to rest.
Okay, so you wake up, Korak, and Sanigar is standing over your bed.
Oh, God.
not creepily, but he's there and he's at the foot of your bed.
Hello, Sanigar.
Hello, Korak. No, you're not in my bed. My bed's right here. I was quite pleased to hear that you had come in to town, and I'm even more pleased to know that you're staying here. Are you all available for a small trek? I know you're in the middle of something, but I have something even more urgent.
If Rorin's not in the room, I would at least want to pull him into this.
Yeah. It's like morning, first thing in the morning.
I would at least, like, I guess to speed it up, I would kind of discuss with Rorin. It's like, hey, I think there's an important thread we need to pull out here, but what exactly are we doing? Are we doing anything with your family? Do we need to... I don't want to, like, ditch your family if they need us right now.
Well, doesn't look good to have Shrike priests dead in their house right now.
Sanigar, you've lived a long time and you've seen a lot of stuff change. So if you say something's urgent, I imagine it's very urgent.
It is. And we can come back. We can be back before midday. I have something I need you all to see. Or at least you and Rorin.
I should tell you, Sanigar, my memories are back, so I do know Bear can exist.
This helps immensely.
Okay, good.
That grand reveal is unnecessary now.
Look upon the Bear King.
Carised looks at you guys and he's like, because Rorin, we can't really do anything until after midday anyway. That's when the changing of the guard, so to speak, happens. If you want to go with him, he's got his own roots. I'll take the rest of the group and we can figure out something to do. make sure that Reardon stays safe and healthy and
work. Sounds good. Just make sure they saved enough wine for me later.
He gives you a wink, a knowing wink. Okay, so just as like a quick montage, you guys very quickly move through some tunnels, some other buildings, some like broken down trenches, forests, through a section of creek. He's got this whole route. And eventually, Rorin, you start to recognize the country start to turn into bearkin country. See lots and lots of signs on the trees for where the bears are. You can see signs of civilization. And like, there's definitely some sections that you actually recognize that you probably visited as a youth.
Ah, yes. I remember this area.
And he leads you to a cave where there are some bearkins standing out front. And they nod to Sanigar, and then they sort of go to block you three from entering. And Sanigar's like, it's fine. It's fine. They're with me. And they move to let you in. And Sanigar takes you down into this cave, where you end up passing through a couple different compartments. And all of them contain different magical presences. Go ahead and roll Arcana for me, all three of you. Oh my god. All three of you feel very strongly that this cave has a magical presence in it. Very, very, very similar to the shard, the shards that you are holding. Rorin with compassion, Korak with memory.
Korak, do you sense how similar this feels?
It's like something scratching along my bones, yes.
I feel the same.
I've been doing a lot of work over the last 1100 years, 1200 years. It's been a long journey. Korak, you weren't in Dustfall when the gods came down. But I was. I was at the center of the blast, in fact, of the goddess of growth. And watching her divine body sitting in the bottom of that crater, I knew that something was going to have to be done. So I've been on a journey for a long time, and I think you are all ready to hear about it. Assuming that you are familiar with the 12 shards of Malar?
Yes. Let's say we're scholars of them.
Yeah. Well, I've been on a journey to collect those 12 shards. Well, rather, 11. The 12th one is not available. And I've managed to collect 7 over my time. Some time ago, I created the bearkin to keep them safe for me.
You created life?
I did. It was why the world feared the Korinid so much. Our creativity was a sticking point for a lot of people. And he's walking you down this long passageway of tunnel. And this presence is getting stronger and stronger. And he's like, a lot of people tried to wipe us out so that we couldn't do exactly what it is that I'm doing now. And he leads you into a room where this presence is overwhelming. It feels like static electricity every step you take. And he walks you around a corner. There's bearkin everywhere, and they're all armored to the teeth. And he says, I don't know if you remember what the gods looked like, Korak, but I need you to brace yourself for what you're about to see. And he leads you into a final passageway that goes to a big metal door that the bearkin roll away. He takes you into this room and shows you a structure, what can only be described as a bunch of glowing orbs or gemstones, except they exist in such a way that it boggles your mind just to look at it. It almost hurts your eyes. It's like looking into the sun for just a moment and having that burn in your eyes when you look at something else, you can't quite see what's behind that shadow that's now in your vision, except you can see it, but it's taking all your focus. That's a really bad analogy, but that's kind of how this looks when Sanigar shows this to you. And he looks so weary when he looks back at you and points to the structure, and he says, "I've spent the better part of 1,100 years, 1,200 years just collecting these 7. And I've been searching and searching and searching for the other 4. I know where the 12th one lies, and I don't know how I was ever going to do that by myself. I was going to need someone. I haven't been doing all this by myself. I'll introduce you to my team in a minute. But war, growth, structure, power, secrets, preservation, chaos, they're all here. They're all here. And Fersha, the goddess of growth, she was the first to fall. That's how I nearly died 1,500 years ago. She came crashing through the Temple of the 12. And I knew I had to do something. I had to take their essence and put it back together again. I can't stress to you how lonely of a journey this has been. Because nobody understands the importance of piecing Malar back together. Now that his death and self-interest and hatred is the only piece that has consciousness and is ruling the other gods. That's dangerous. And I know you all see it. And that's why I've come to you today. That's why, Korak, I told you about your father. I knew you before as the Harpy Herald, Kandaros. I'm sure you're familiar with that tale by now. That's why I told you in Raylene's chambers who you were, because I knew you didn't know. But I know, because of who your mother was, that you have it in you to accept this truth. Now I expect you're going on to find the other shards. I'm going to get these packaged up and get them to you before you head out of Rivershroud. You must take these with you. Unite them with discovery, with truth or memory, with honor. And when you find love, put them all together and then find a way to get Garrisil to agree to merge them back together with himself. Now, I didn't do this alone, and I didn't do it with just the Bearkin. I think it's time I introduce you to my team. And he walks you to another corridor where a warforged man stands out for. And he says, "Thank you, Gatatok. You can take your leave." And he opens the vault, and there is an elephant with a goblin riding on top of it, and an Aarakocra man with wings spread out in glory, and they are all currently petrified, turned to stone. And we swing all the way back to the Liberators back in Rivershroud. Carised has you guys in a warehouse building, and he's like, "I don't actually know what it is that this guy wants, but we're just going to hear him out." And from what he's told you, I'm not just going to drop you in media res. He's told you that you're supposed to be meeting with somebody, some noble or something like that, was reaching out to the feelers that Carised has in the underground. And these kind of burly dudes wearing like Secret Service uniforms come walking into this building, and They look like maybe they would have been prepared to try to like bully Carised a little bit, but they weren't expecting him to have backup. And he's like, he just kind of smiles. He gives like a knowing smile. He's like, yeah, that's like a, yeah, nice try. And they're like, we represent the interests of one Mr. Craven. Lord Craven, excuse me. And he needs your help. And he has information for you from the inside and can probably give a lot of sway. He's got lots of money. They rub their fingers together and they're like, so we'll, if you're willing to work with us, maybe we can talk this out. And that's actually where we're going to end for tonight.
Is that the petrified party from one of the one shots? They sounded familiar.
Yeah, that's yeah. Gotta talk. Orbis.
And Orzo.
Orzo and Hazard of Flame with Hazard's elephant Gambi. Gambo. Gamba? Dumbo.
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 Yes, they were preserved.
I was gonna comment, but I was just like in so much like I was trying to collect myself, but it's like a weird way of keeping your coworkers alive past their lifespan. Wow.
Alright. Yeah, well thanks everybody for getting on.
yeah. That was so good.
Thank you, Ace.
Thank you. Rolls.
Nice to have a last second session. Yeah, I know that was super short notice, and so I know that like the joke is that we don't have anything else to do on during quarantine, but it still means a lot that you guys all rally together and get this going.